Hello butterflies, and this video is going to be my wrap up for June and July. So first I'm going to come to you from the future, because the next video is going to be from the past. I did record my June wrap up, but I didn't post it. So after July was over, I'm like, I don't know, it's kind of late to post it, but I wanted to share with y'all what I read. So I'm just going to film my July wrap up and just put both of the videos together. And so it's going to be my June and my July. It's just June is already done. June was recorded way back when. And I'm going to be recording July today. So y'all can stay tuned, because here is my June wrap up. In June, I read 9 books, and I have my Kindle, because 8 of those books were on my Kindle. I only have 1 book that I physically have that I read. And then 6 of those books were graphic novels, so I read a lot of graphic novels in June. But I still had a really good reading month, to be honest. I think it was either above like a 50% really great reading month overall, or at the 50% mark, because I did have some books that I was a little iffy about.
Oh, and this is Seymour. Everyone, this is Seymour. I just got him almost a week ago, got him Sunday. And he is my test subject. I really want to get into potty training, and I'm just figured I'll get some supplements, because then if I kill it, then that means I don't need to do anything potty or garden related at all. I just need to stop. So I figured if I do Seymour, and he lasts a while, then I, you know, it's gonna boost my confidence to do more.
Okay, so the first book that I read in June was Coyotes Volume 1 by Sean Lewis, and I gave it 3 stars. And it was pretty good. Like, I thought it was a cover read. I picked it up. It was also one of my challenges for the Last Person Standing challenge. But I seen the cover and I was like really drawn to it. So because it was a cover read, I really figured that the story itself was gonna suck, but it didn't. It was actually pretty entertaining. It was pretty freaking good. I would read the second volume whenever it came out, because I think this one just came out this year. But it's not marketed as a Little Red Riding Hood story officially, but I would market it as a Little Red Riding Hood retelling, because that's almost like it was like it's about this town called the City of Lost Girls, where women are just going missing, and the locals know that it's these like werewolves that the men turn into werewolves and they attack the females, and so a lot of women have died and girls have died and gone missing because of this. But there's like a FBI, I guess, like an FBI investigation into it, but they don't believe the locals that it's actually like werewolves, because who would believe that it's werewolves, right? So it's about this girl, Red, right? It's not marketed as a Literary Riding Hood, but her name is Red, and she's 13, and she's going on this mission because her sister died and also her mother died by the hands of these wolves. So she's going on this mission to bring them to justice, bring their deaths to justice, and to fix what's going on in their town, to try to fix it at least. And so it's like this whole like underground like circle of women that are pretty much like street fighters, but for against werewolves, and it's like it's really awesome. It was really cool, it's really entertaining, but sometimes it did drift into that territory where I was just like, okay, I'm getting bored and I'm getting uninterested, and then something else would happen to get me back into it. There was a lot of action. I loved all the action that was in it. I also loved at the end they had like mug shots at the end. I just thought it was the best thing ever. It was like they made me laugh, because they would do the mug shots, but then they had like subtitles for whoever's in the mug shot, and it was funny. So I really enjoyed it. I had my last moments. There were serious moments. I loved the action in it. It was good. It was good enough to where I would actually pick up the second volume just to try it out. And then I read Snot Girl Volume 1 by Brian Lee O'Malley. I gave it 2.5 stars. I'm just not a big fan of Snot Girl. And it's crazy, because a lot of people on BookTube are crazy over Snot Girl. They love it. That's one of their favorites. But I just was not that into it. First of all, Lottie as a person is not really a character, a main character that I want to follow around and care about, because I feel like she's a very materialistic and a very selfish, very shallow person, because all she worries about is herself. So if you don't know what Snot Girl is about, which I still kind of don't know what it's about, but it's about this girl named Lottie. She's like this big blogger, and it's like she has one life on blogs and, you know, on Instagram, and everybody thinks it's like, oh yeah, she's really cool, she has good fashion, but then in real life she has really, really bad allergies, and that's like the end of her whole life, because she has really bad allergies. And it's like a whole bunch of crazy shit started happening after that. Like, it's like she started taking these pills, and then she met this some kind of other blogger, a newer blogger, and some weird crazy shit really just started happening. That's why like I still don't kind of know what it is, and that's why I kind of gave it 2.5 stars, because it had its moments, but like I said, her as a person is terrible, and then I still don't know what it's about after I read a whole volume. It's just like, it really mixed up on me, and I'm just like, what the hell is going on? What's happening? Because I'm really lost right now, and I really don't know what the fuck is going on and what's happening. So, it's just not for me. And then I read Saga Volume 1 by Brian K. Vaughan, and I gave that 5 stars. I loved it so much. I'm definitely a believer of Saga, because everybody goes crazy for Saga over BookTube. It's just like with Snotgirl. It's like a lot of people go crazy over it, and it's really hyped up, and then you're like, I don't know how I'm gonna like this. But then when I started reading it, like, just instantly, I was instantly drawn to the characters. For some reason, I just fell in love with the characters just like automatically. And my first thoughts was like, oh my god, I really love these characters, and I don't even know them yet. Like, I'm just meeting them. I love them so much. So Saga is following these two different races, I guess you could say. Marco is like, I don't want to call him a demon, but he has one. I don't know. Look, okay. Don't get on me because I don't know the specifics. I can't remember what their like specific origin is or whatever. But Marco is one race and Alana is another race. And their races are fighting against each other. So it's like for them to be together is a big no-no. That's like a forbidden thing. But not only were they together, they had a baby together. So that's like a huge no-no. And so they're on the run because like each of their people, their races, are trying to find them and kill them and their baby. So they're like running around trying to, you know, just find a safe space for them to raise their family and to get away from everybody. And oh my god, it's fucking amazing. Like, there's so much action going on. It's really, 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 really good. Like, really, really good. And I read this on Hoopla. Go and check Hoopla out if you haven't already. So it was amazing. I'm about to go and read volume 2 when I get the chance. It was like really good. Then I read The Hazelwood by Melissa Elbert. And I'm not going to get too deep into this because this is a book that I do want to do like a full review on, because I have a lot of thoughts about it. I only gave it 3 stars. It was good, but I wish it was better. Like, I really wanted more from it. And then when it got to the end of the book, you could tell like it almost, like she was running out of steam writing it when it got to the end, and she just started just throwing it together to try to end the story. Because at the end, a lot of the stories just got mixed up and jumping up. And I just wish it was better than what it was, to at least get me to a 4-star instead of a 3-star. So if you don't know, The Hazelwood is about this girl named Ella. She's 17 years old, and her mother has been on the run basically her whole life. And it seems like everywhere they go, really bad luck just follows them everywhere. And not just small things, like huge things, bad luck wise, follows them everywhere. They get a letter from her grandmother one day saying that basically she's died. And her grandmother was this author of this like amazing like cult classic. It was like dark fairy tales that it's like you can't even find copies of it anymore, and editions of it are just so expensive. It's crazy. So they get that letter, they think the bad luck is over, and then she comes home from school one day and her mother has been kidnapped by these people that call themselves the Hiddling. So Alice must go to Hazelwood to find and rescue her mother. But it's like things start really turning really dark and really weird, and it's really crazy. But like I said, it was good, but I wish it would have been better. As much as people raved about it, I thought it was gonna be way better than, you know, what it was. It started off kind of slow, and then it started to pick up, and then things at the end just got really jumbled. I'm gonna talk about it in my review because it's a lot. And then I listened to The Bad Beginning, which is the first book for A Series of Unfortunate Events by Lemony Snicket, and I gave it 3 stars. I watched the movie like a long time ago when the movie came out, but I never read the book, so don't kill me. I've never read the books. This is the first one. I listened to it for one of my challenges. It was pretty good. I gave it 3 stars. I feel like some of the audio could have been better, because sometimes you couldn't hear the narrator because they had so many different like sound effects going on while the narrator's talking. And it's just, it could have been better. But I loved the movie. I definitely loved the movie. But story-wise, it was a pretty good story. And then I read I Hate Fairyland Volume 1 by Scotty Young, and I gave it 3 stars. Now, when I first picked this up, I thought, you know, it was going to be, you know, cutesy, innocent. And then I started reading it, and I was like, wait, hold up. I was like, okay, it's got adult content. Because I didn't know it was like an adult graphic novel. I just thought, you know, it was YA. But it's like the stuff in it was like adult-ish. And so I was just like, oh, I like this. This is really good. It made me laugh. But then a lot of times, though, I did keep falling into the boring zone where I was getting bored with whatever was going on at the moment. And I was just Like, come on, I started to speed read through some of it. So it's like, I hate when that happens, especially the graphic novel. It's like, okay. The art was really cutesy. It was like, I really liked the graphic. It was very beautiful. I liked the concept of being trapped in a fairyland. Like, you would think that would be the perfect place that you wanted to go. You'd be so happy all the time. And then to be trapped there for 27 years. I liked the spin that it took. I really did. And you know what? She might have been there for more than 27 years. Because I think she was a 47-year-old woman. And she went there when she was 6. Or a 40-year-old woman. And she went there when she was 6. And she had been trapped there all that time. It was really amazing to see that separate side of always being happy, happy, happy. To be stuck there for so long. To see what it can do to you. Like, really drive you insane. I can't wait to read the second volume. Like, I really enjoyed myself when I was reading it. And I should have read it a long time ago, and I just didn't. Then I read Babies in Black by Arne Bellstrop. This is a library book that I had. I picked it up because I thought it was going to be interesting to me. It's about the Beatles and their fifth member. I really thought that I was going to be way more into it than what I was. Maybe it's because I'm not really a big Beatles fan or like a big Beatles fanatic person. It was pretty boring. I gave it 2 stars. The graphics, everything was in black and white, which doesn't bother me, but like, just not even looking at it's black and white, the graphics, other than being black and white, weren't anything that were mind-blowing or amazing. It could have been better. The storyline was just really boring and really dry, and I just was like, this is really boring. Like, I could have spiced it up a little bit more. So I just really wasn't that into it. Even at the end, when we're supposed to be heartbroken, I was just like, okay, sad, but you know, it wasn't getting me to tears like I guess you were supposed to be. So I was just like, yeah, this is not what I expected. I was a little disappointed. And then I read Heavy Vinyl Volume 1 by Carly Houston? I don't know, but I gave this 4 stars. I really enjoyed this. A little while ago, I think I read like the first 3 issues, and then I was on Book Depository and it seemed like they had like a whole volume. So I was like, this is something I would buy myself because I really liked the first 3 volumes. So I bought the actual physical thing. I love this so much, y'all. It's so good. I can't wait for the second volume to come out, if there's gonna be a second volume. But it's just so, I don't know how to explain it, y'all. Okay, so it's about this girl named Chris. She starts working at like a record store, and she thinks, you know, she's just trying to fit in, and she thinks like it's just a record store, but it's not. It's like way more than a record store. The record store itself, when they close, the girls that work at the record store, they are part of like this underground, like, street fighting vigilante group, right? And they pretty much just rescue famous people, I guess you say. And oh my god, it was really awesome. I really enjoyed it. I'm trying to watch Chris fit in, and Chris is a lesbian, I think she is. Yeah, Chris is a lesbian, and just trying to watch her fit into this group that she didn't even know what was going on, and she's never even had to fight before in her life, and now she's trying to fit in with this group of like pretty, really awesome girls. By the way, the characters were really great. I really enjoyed this graphic novel, y'all. Like, I want more people to see it. I did see someone else mention it. I was just like, yeah, it's awesome. You're gonna enjoy yourself. I think it was Hardback Hoarder that I seen mention this. This is really amazing. I really enjoyed reading this, y'all. Like, I hope more people check it out. You can even just go, because on Hoopla, no, they don't pay me, but maybe one day they might come my way with the offer. But Hoopla has, like, the single issues. I don't think they have, like, the full volume. They might have the full volume on there, too. So if you don't want to pay your money for it, that's fine. You can go and check it out for free. I've never seen these in the library, or I just not never paid attention, but I'm pretty sure you can check your library too and see if they have it. It was amazing, and I really think you guys should read it and give it a try. And then I read Into the Wild by John Croker, and I gave it 3 stars. I read this for a challenge, and while I'm reading it, I'm pretty sure, I'm almost positive, like I'm 90% sure I had to read this for school at some point, because you know when you're reading something, it just sounds really familiar, like you had to read it before. I'm pretty sure I read this for school at some point when I was in like high school. I'm pretty sure I read it. So it was like reading it, I was like, yeah, this is very familiar. But I read this for one of the tasks for the Last Person Standing Challenge. You had to read a book that had mountains on the cover, and I just read that edition. It had the mountains on the cover, and I gave it 3 stars. I want to say I wrote a review, but I'm not 100%. But this is also a book that I wanted like a full review on. I enjoyed reading it. Like, it just brought a lot. I think I read it already before. I wasn't really into it. But now reading it as I'm older, it's like it's more of an active reader than what I used to be. It really brought me to questions of I can't remember the guy that, I think his name was Chris. But was he mentally ill? Like, it brings up a lot of questions. How one day you're like this perfect, you know, family guy, you went to college, you have a college degree, and then the next day you sold everything, you have no money, and you're just deciding to backpack and just be homeless. And it's like, it really does bring the question of, was something wrong with him? Was he okay? Mentally, I don't know. It just brought up a lot of questions that I never thought about before. But it is about this guy named Chris. He came from a well family, a well-off family. Like I said, he was college educated. The next step was to go to law school. He had the money to go, like cash money, you know, not scholarships. So they were really well off. And he just decided after he graduated college just to drop everything, sell everything, give away all the money he had. He donated all of the money that he had for law school, to go to law school. He donated all of that to a charity. He left his car abandoned. He gave away everything and then decided to be a backpacker, hitchhiker, or whatever. Just basically to be homeless and to live in the Alaskan wild for maybe, I think he was supposed to stay for a couple months or so. I can't remember. But hikers end up finding his dead body in an abandoned bus, and it's pretty much just following, you know, his journals and what we could try to piece together for what happened and what was going on. And no one knows the exact cause of why he died. They found his bones, his remains were, I think his remains, they say, was like 80 pounds, 70 pounds. He had no visible broken bones, of no one knows why he died. So it's basically just piecing together his life with other people that he traveled with and listening to other people that he stayed with, giving their accounts of, you know, the kind of guy he was and how long they stayed in touch, stuff like that, and how his death and his presence affected those people that he passed by and passed with. And it was just, it really brought a lot of questions, you know. So yeah, we are gonna talk about it because, like I said, this is a book I want to do a review for, and it's gonna make the video kind of long. So guys, that is all nine books that I read in the month of June. So now on with my July wrap up. In July, I read 7 books, and none of them was physical books. I don't know what's been happening with me lately. I've been reading a lot on my Kindle more than my physical books, and I'm feeling kind of like I'm cheating on my physical books. But I didn't just start reading some of the books on my Kindle too, because I had a bunch of books on my Kindle that I never touched. So the first thing that I read in July was actually a NetGalley book, and it's The 12 Lives of Samuel Hawley by Hannah Tinty, and I gave it 3 stars. I was supposed to read this book last year and I didn't. I'm just starting to get through my NetGalley books. But it's a dual perspective novel following a daughter and a father. The dad name is Sam. I cannot remember what the daughter's name is Lou. I remember it was something weird and very boyish, and I was like, okay. But anyway, the book is a mix up between flashback chapters and present chapters. Our flashback chapters follow Sam and how he got shot 12 times, and each flashback chapter is about one of those shots, one of those bullet wounds that he has on his body. And then the present day chapters are the chapters that is about Lou and following what she's going through now, currently, like trying to figure out herself and figure out who her mother was, because her mother died when she was really young. So she's just trying to remember her and figure herself out, pretty much. It was okay, but to say it was a dual perspective book, I really got more of Lou's perspective than I did for Sam. And I didn't like how the flashback scenes were incorporated into the book. It wasn't a transition, it just hit you and it's like, oh, it at first it's like you're reading a chapter and it's like, what the hell am I reading? This is not what I was just reading before. And then halfway through that chapter, you're like, oh, okay, this is about Sam's first bullet wound. So I'm like, okay, that's cool, I guess. But I wish it would have transitioned better into those chapters. It just kind of caught you off guard, and it's almost like it was 2 different books mashed together. But I did write my review, so my review's on my blog and it's on Goodreads as well if y'all want to go and check that out. Okay, so then the second book that I read, well actually I listened to, was Burned by Ellen Hopkins, and I listened to this on audiobook via Hoopla, so y'all can check Hoopla out, whichever side. They don't pay me to advertise to them, but I really think they're a really good app and they're free. It's linked with your library, so it's completely free, but you do have to have a library card. You get limited access for I think a week without the library card, but it's library card is free. You can get a library card and you have unlimited access with Hoopla. So I listened to Burn by Ellen Hopkins and it was freaking amazing. Like I listened to it in one night. I think it was only maybe a 3 hour or 4 hour audiobook, but it was fucking amazing. I ended up giving it 4 stars. Like I just was so, I've read Ellen Hopkins before, I read her Crank series, but I've never listened to it. So this is the second series by her that I'm reading and I really enjoyed. I love Ellen Hopkins so far. Like I love her writing so far. It was really amazing and I need to read Smoked, which is the second book to it. And I'm going to listen to that one too. But I think that one is 8 hours instead of the 3 or 4 that Burned was. But it was absolutely amazing. It was very emotional, as I'm pretty sure all of her books are. And then I read Hot and Bothered by Ellie Kennedy. I don't know how you pronounce her name. But I enjoyed it. I gave it 3 stars, I believe. No, I gave it 4 stars. My bad. I gave it 4 stars. I want to say it's a short story collection because I wouldn't call it a short story collection. But the novel is filled with 3 different stories following these 3 Navy SEALs. Are they Navy SEALs? I think they're SEALs. I'm pretty sure they're SEALs, but they work together and they're friends, and the second story picks up where the first one left off, the third one picks up where the second one left off. So they all link together. They're following, the first one is following Shelby and Garrett. And when I tell y'all, each 3 of these stories have like a totally different vibe to them and different personality. Yes, it did. I'm going to say the second one was my favorite one because I laughed more in the second story. The first story follows Shelby and Garrett. And that one, it was pretty steamy, but it was mostly unrealistic things that happened. But overall, it was pretty cute adult novel. It was adult romance. So it was pretty cute. Okay, but it was very unrealistic in some areas, so it's like that shit would never happen. But the second book, which I say was my favorite, the second story in the novel, follows Carson and Holly. And this one, it was unrealistic as well. It had unrealistic areas in it. I was like, that would never happen. But it was also funny. Their story was more comedic. And they were the more relatable couple out of all 3 couples. They were the most relatable, so I think that's why I really enjoyed them more. But of course that was, and I can't tell you what the unrealistic thing is because they kind of go hand in hand with story 1 and 2. It's the same thing and it's all because of the exact same experience that happened between these characters, so I can't tell you that. But the second one was my favorite. The last story I wasn't that impressed. But it follows Will and Mackenzie, and it was pretty much porn on paper. Like, you know, the first 2 stories were like, okay, it's a nice little romantic novel. Of course, there was sex in it, whatever. But then the last one was just like sex every other page. It was just like writing a script for a porno. That's what the last story was. I just felt like she wasn't trying anymore on the last one. The last one, she was just like, I'm just gonna write about sex, and that's it. She didn't really worry about, I need to have an actual like plot for these characters. They had like a thin line plot, but it wasn't anything that was really like other than porn. Like it was pretty much just sex, sex, sex. They didn't really have, they had their issues, but she didn't really elaborate on them like she did with the last 2 stories. Long story short, I ran out of steam, and I think she did too by the time we got to the 3rd story. But as an overall, the book altogether was pretty good, and I would recommend it if you don't have a problem with reading sex, because I know some people are like, oh my god, Jesus help me, I don't read those things. So if you're not that person, then you'll enjoy it, because I did. And then the 4th book that I read in July was the complete collection of poems by Maya Angelou, and it was fucking amazing. Like, I read some of her poetry, but not all of it. So reading all of it, I really enjoyed it. I gave it 4 stars. It was really good. Like, I couldn't help. It's like, I love how Maya Angelou has just like, just She had like this perfect storytelling voice. Like I could just sit there and listen to her read books to me all the time. Like I loved her voice. And so it's like anytime I read anything that's by her, the voice inside of my head reading is her voice. So I loved it so much. Of course, there were fan favorites that you see everywhere, like Phenomenal Woman. But the collection as a whole was really great. I really felt emotionally connected because I really think Maya Angelou, I call Maya Angelou like my poetry godmother or my literary grandmother. Like I loved her so freaking much. Like I always say, especially after she died, I really wanted to read everything that she touched. So I completed all of her poems and I read YK's Bird Sings. But there's still a couple other books that I want to read by her. But oh my God, I really enjoyed it. I recommend it to you if you're like a poetry buff like myself or just interested in Maya Angelou period. I really recommend it because it was really amazing for me. Like I just felt so emotionally connected to her reading. And then I read Black Butterfly by Robert M. Drake and I gave that 3 stars. This was also a collection of poetry. I gave it 3 stars. It's like I liked it. But I liked it, I didn't love it. I just wish I was more emotionally connected with the poems themselves. Like, you know, when I read poetry, I like to feel what that poet is feeling. And I wasn't feeling it. It's just like something was missing. I just really wished I would have been more in tune with it itself. So basically this collection is about, Robert wrote this collection of poetry for his brother after he died. Of everything he wanted to say about him that he didn't get the chance to say before he died. So, I hope y'all got what I said because I feel like I just turned myself around. But I liked it. I just wish I would have loved it and I didn't love it. Then the 6th book that I read last month was The 14 Goldfish by Jennifer L. Holm. And this was a middle grade novel and I believe I gave it 3 stars as well. The only reason I came across this book was because I had a challenge for the last person standing challenge. And it was to read a book with a fish on the cover. And so I just was looking through books with fishes on the cover. And I was like, oh, it's a middle grade novel. It'll be quick. So I can quickly get my points and I'll make sure I get my points for this book. But I actually ended up liking it. And this is actually a book that I probably would end up adding to Kalea's like to read shelf when she gets older. Because it's a middle grade novel, so she's not there yet. But I enjoyed it. We follow our main character, Ellie. And she ends up meeting her grandfather all over again, but long story short, the grandfather has found like this serum, like pretty much the Fountain of Youth. He's created it and he drunk it. So instead of him being this old man, now he's an 11-year-old boy, like she is. So they're pretty much the same age, and she's looking at him, she's like, I know you. You look very familiar. And then she realizes he has his class ring on his finger, and she's like, oh, grandpa. So basically, it's about them trying to break into his lab and get his supplies so he can mass produce the Fountain of Youth and make sure he gets his credit where it's due. And it follows them going through this journey, getting to re-know each other and getting it pretty much it goes through the journey of Ellie kind of realizing what death is about. With death comes life, and without death, you know, there won't be any life. It's like you'll get tired of living as everybody being kids, pretty much living the same existence over and over and over again. You know, people have to die, and that's pretty much what this what the end pretty much comes to, her realizing this. And I really enjoyed that it went through that. But I really liked it. It had kind of like an educational standpoint to it because it has a lot of science in it, and I love science, so I was just really amazed that they incorporated science in it without making it boring, but making it really interesting. And I think that has to do with the whole plot of it being the Fountain of Youth, which makes it so interesting. Character-wise, though, Ellie was freaking amazing. She was only 11 years old, but Jennifer wrote this book to where it's like you forget that she's 11 years old. Which not in a bad way. It was actually a wonderful thing for 2 reasons. For one reason, it's like even though we forget, like you read this, you kind of forget that she's 11. She still stays true to her 11-year-old characteristics, and I think that was important because a lot of times in middle grade novels these days, you'll have an 11-year-old character that acts like she's 30 and it's like she's doing stuff 11-year-olds will never do. But in this book, she stayed true to these 11-year-old characteristics, but it wasn't overly childish. But it stayed true to these characteristics where it's like, yeah, I can see a child, an 11-year-old doing this. You know, 11-year-olds can see themselves doing it. It wasn't impossible for an 11-year-old to do. But then also, the second reason I really like that you kind of forget how old she is for adults like me reading it, you don't get that overly childish feeling, and you don't get like, yeah, I don't really want to read this anymore because this is way too childish, you know. So I like that it keeps me engaged in the story. The bad thing that I had, I really wish Melvin, which is supposed to be, which is her grandpa, but I wish he would have had more character development. I don't feel like his character really developed too much, and I don't like how it ended, how the book ended with him. I feel like there was more of her story to be told, and I just feel like she put like a neat little bow on the end and like the end. I just wish it would have been more, and I felt like I was left hanging, and that's why I gave it 3 stars. But I think I actually gave it 3.5 stars. I think I gave it 3.5 stars because I liked it, but you know, that was really bothering me. But as a whole, altogether, I wouldn't say it's like one of my favorite middle grade novels. It's not the best middle grade novel I've read, but it is one of those in my top numbers. I'm like, okay, I really like this, and I would share this with my child, or I would share this with other kids and recommend it to other middle grade readers or adults that are really into middle grade, because I really enjoyed it. I liked it, but you know, I didn't love it. I wasn't in love with it. I was almost in love with it, but I wasn't there. And then the last book that I read in July was The Second Draft by C.M. Seabrook. And this is also an adult romance novel. I gave it 4 stars because I was this close to loving it. I was this close. Like, I was so close to being in love with this book. But something was really missing. Okay, so first of all, like, it's a sticky situation in this book. So this book is about this girl named Layla, and she's in love with Carter. Well, when she first meets him, you know, she likes him. She's like, oh, okay, he's interesting. He really draws my attention. But he accidentally gives her the wrong number. So they lose touch. In that time of them losing touch, she ends up moving in with Travis, and she ends up getting pregnant for Travis. Where the turn in the sticky situation comes in, she ends up finding out that Travis is Carter's brother. So it's like, damn, I got pregnant for your brother on accident. It was a complete accident. She was drunk one day, and he actually took advantage of her being drunk, and that's how that happened. Like, she really was not into him at all. She doesn't want a relationship with Travis at all. She wants Carter. But throughout the whole book, you know, just on her mind, like, I can't be, even though Carter is like, I will take care of you, I really like you, and I'm falling in love with you. I don't care if that's my brother's baby. I don't care, right? So it's just the whole book, she was, you know, she's going through this phase where, which I get, it's just like, no, this is wrong because I'm pregnant for your brother. Like, this is so weird. I'm pregnant for your brother. I can't be with you. What are people going to think? I understand that. I totally get that. It kind of got annoying. So I'm like, let it go. Okay, sis, let it go. The man said he don't care. He don't care. He's told you many times in many different ways he does not care. He still wants you because Travis wants nothing to do with the baby. So Carter is willing to take that on, and he's just like, I will take you as I will take y'all as my family. You know, I will raise this child like he's mine, because they're related anyway. So like I said, the plot was very different because it was a very sticky situation it was revolving around. I did find myself having a lot of emotional outbursts while I was reading this. Like, I would be laughing out loud 1 minute and giggling, and then the next minute I'm like upset and angry, and the next minute I'm like almost close to tears because I'm like, oh my god, no, this is not happening. But I really loved it. It had me on the emotional level that was 100% perfect. The thing that really got me, like, I was this close from loving it, was I didn't really see the growth in Layla's and Carter's relationship. Well, I don't want to say I didn't see the growth. It wasn't consistent for me. Like, some points in the book, it seemed like their relationship was moving way too fast. And then some parts of the book, it didn't seem like it was moving at all. So it didn't have consistent growth. It was like, sometimes we're growing and then we took 10 steps back, and now we took 5 steps forward to get not 8 steps back. Like, it didn't seem like it was really consistent. And there were also some things that were very unrealistic that got me rolling my eyes, but it wasn't anything that I was like, you know, throw it away. I wasn't in the throw it away mood. So it wasn't bad. So it didn't hurt the book for me, but it was on my mind that this shit would never happen, like, for real, for real. Like, this is unrelatable. Like, this, I'm pretty sure it happens sometimes, but it would never pan out like this. There's no way. But in the end, I still couldn't help myself rooting for them. Like, I rooted for them throughout the whole book. Like, I wanted them to be together. I wanted them to get their relationship on track. I really loved the book. I couldn't put it down. Oh, and another thing I didn't understand Carter's, like, his primal instinct. Like, he was just, everything is just mine. So she's mine, and the baby's mine. Like, it's mine. Like, I don't get his attitude about that. Like, I'm just... She's not property, you know, she's not an object, she's a person, okay? You can't own her. She's a person, she's a human. You can't own them, you know? So that part I wasn't connecting with him on that because I was just like, I don't like that overbearingness. I'm like, oh, you're mine. It's like, no, no, she's a human. You can't own her. Okay, so that's my wrap up for June and July at this current moment. I can't remember how many books I read in June. I'm pretty sure I read 6 or 7 books in June. I'm pretty sure. I thought I had it written down somewhere, but I'm pretty sure it was maybe 6 or 7 books I read in June. So that would make my total 14-ish, you know, 14, 13-ish, depending on how many I read last month. But I really, looking at these 2 months, I've had a really good reading month. This summer has been amazing. I've been having a pretty good reading month all year, so I'm very proud of myself. So guys, thank you guys for sticking in for this. I'm pretty sure it's gonna be a long video. Thank you guys for sticking in and watching this video, and I hope you guys enjoyed it. Comment down below what you guys read last month or in June or over the summer period, I would like to know. And yeah, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. See you later. Bye. Fuck it up, ah, 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 let's go. Ah, throw that ass in the circle. Ah.